name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
My brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins, so as to prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess,
O my God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned, in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Glory to God in the highest.
And on earth, peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory. Lord God, Heavenly King, O God, Almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only begotten Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, with the glorious transfiguration of your only begotten Son, confirm the mysteries of faith by the witness of the fathers, and wonderfully prefigure our full adoption to sonship. Grant, we pray, to your servants that listening to the voice of your beloved Son, we may merit to become co-heirs with him, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
As I watched, thrones were set up, and the Ancient One took his throne. His clothing was bright as snow, and the hair on his head as white as wool. His throne was flames of fire, and wheels of burning fire. A surging stream of fire flowed out from where he sat. Thousands upon thousands were ministering to him, and myriads upon myriads attended him. The court was convened and the books were opened. As the visions during the night continued, I saw one like a Son of Man coming from the clouds of heaven. When he reached the Ancient One and was presented before him, the one like a Son of Man received dominion, glory, and kingship. All peoples, nations, and languages serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that shall not be taken away. His kingship shall not be destroyed. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord is King, the Most High over all the earth.
The Lord is King, the Most High over all the earth.
The Lord is King, let the earth rejoice. Let the many islands be glad. Clouds of darkness are round about him. Justice and judgments are the foundation of his throne.
The Lord is King, the Most High over all the earth.
The mountains melt like wax before the Lord, before the Lord of all the earth. The heavens proclaim his justice, and all people see his glory.
The Lord is King, the Most High over all the earth.
Because you, O Lord, are the Most High over all the earth, exalted far above all gods.
The Lord is King, the Most High over all the earth.
A reading from the second letter of St. Peter.
Beloved, we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we had eyewitnesses of his majesty, for he received honor and glory from God the Father when that unique declaration came to him from the majestic glory. This is my Son, my beloved, with whom I am well pleased. We ourselves heard this voice come from heaven while we were with him on the holy mountain. Moreover, we possess the prophetic message that is altogether reliable. You will do well to be attentive to it, as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia. Two men were conversing with him, Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory and spoke of his exodus that he was going to accomplish in Jerusalem. Peter and his companions had been overcome by sleep, but becoming fully awake, they saw his glory and the two men standing with him. As they were about to part from him, Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." But he did not know what he was saying. While he was still speaking, a cloud came and cast a shadow over them. They became frightened when they entered the cloud. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my chosen Son. Listen to him." After the voice had spoken, Jesus was found alone. They fell silent and did not at that time tell anyone what they had seen. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
The beautiful Feast of the Transfiguration. In each Gospel episode, you and I are definitely there. We're not bystanders, we're just listeners. We're right there in every Gospel scene, as Jesus speaks to us. He takes Peter, James, and John up this high, lofty mountain called Mount Tabor. First of all, why Peter, James, and John? Scripture scholars will tell us they were most frightened of the approaching death of the Lord. We all understand that these people knew what a crucifixion was. They've witnessed crucifixions. And they could not even imagine in their wildest dreams that the Son of God would endure such a death. They were frightened. But Jesus wanted to assure them and assure us that it does not end with death. Our faith becomes stronger each time when God reveals things to us. And so Jesus takes them up a high, lofty mountain. because all of us are steeped in understanding Scripture, we know that mountains are a very special place in Scripture. It's where God speaks to his chosen ones. He spoke to the prophets. Jesus, of course, speaks on the mount as he gives his great sermon, and then Mount Calvary, where he dies. But look at this mount, Mount Tabor, where he's transfigured before them. Could you imagine seeing that transfiguration, giving them a glimpse of the transfigured, glorified body of God? I should probably help us to understand that, really, they were the first ones to see this type of body. Mary Magdalene was blessed after the death, but they were blessed before it. His face became so white and dazzling as one of his clothes. He was transfigured before them. Peter says, it's good that we're here. Let me erect three booths, or three tents, because Moses and Elijah are there. How beautiful that Moses, representing the law, because Moses wrote the Torah, right? The first five books of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. And then Elijah representing the prophets, those two great pillars in which God continued to speak to his people. But now he speaks perfectly through his son. So Moses and Elijah were there, and it's only a validation to Peter, James, and John about the total fulfillment of God's plan, that God spoke through the law and spoke through the prophets. But now he speaks perfectly through his son, Christ, the Lord. So Moses and Elijah were there, and Peter says, let me erect three tents, three dwelling places, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. They knew that God was speaking. They knew something tremendously different has happened at this moment. They were filled with a sense of fright, but a holy fear, and a sense of peace. They were blessed to see this transfigured body before the resurrection as a glimpse to it. And they hear the voice of the Father from the cloud. I guess we all remember about how God spoke to Moses through the cloud as the Israelites were leaving Egypt, and how perfectly his voice was heard. And they followed the cloud. Moses guided them into freedom, from sin to life, away from vice to virtue. They were being saved. It was definitely a Passover. And the voice of the Father was heard from the cloud once again. All of these things began to make sense for them. And Peter, James, and John, their anxiety and their fear was becoming more and more dissipated. Now they can understand the plan of God. In fact, in other accounts of this gospel text, Peter wants just to stay there. Why go down now if we have a glimpse of heaven? The security of heaven, the joy of heaven, the peace of heaven. Lord, I don't want to go down. I want to stay up here with you. No, Peter, you must go down. The hour has not yet come. I'm just bringing you here to allow your fears to be lessened, to allow allow you to understand, to all of us to understand, that it doesn't end in death. Do you realize this? It doesn't end with death. It's eternal life. And I brought you up here to allow you to understand and to witness what will happen. The voice of the Father was heard. The same voice of the Father at the beginning of the public ministry. Remember when John was baptizing at the River Jordan? And Jesus came on the scene and asked to be baptized, to make those waters sacramental, to be the author of baptism. And what happened? The heavens rent open, and the voice of the Father was heard at the beginning of the public ministry. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. Easier said than done, right? And that's why we come before him every day in this upper room at Mount Tabor, as Christ gives us himself in his transfigured, glorious body and blood. We listen to him in his word. I mentioned this before. Remember, pulpits or ambos were constructed in many churches to be up high. In fact, you had to walk up steps. And the whole reason of that construction was that it was to give a sense of a mountain. That's why they created them like that. Because the voice of the Father was heard. How beautiful in Catholic architecture that we not only put up functional buildings, but buildings that are cohesive to faith and have a meaning and a purpose. The voice of the Father is heard, and we're called to listen to him in faith, to calm our fears and our anxieties, especially about death, which is scary for all of us. But to know that it doesn't end that way. The whole reason and purpose that Christ came was to bring us life. And isn't it beautiful that we have a foretaste of that right here in the upper room, where he's transfigured before us. And not only that, when you and I receive communion, are we not also transfigured? Don't we also have a glimpse of the kingdom of God in which we shall be one day in our glorified body? Don't we receive him whom we become more and more because of our reception? Absolutely. This text tells us that they fell silent and did not tell anyone what they had seen. They needed time to process this. You and I do too. After communion, we go back and we make a prayer of thanksgiving. It's too much for us to understand what we have just received. And we go back to our pews silent, not saying anything, and taking it all in. Let us continue to pray for one another as we are on the journey. And let us pray for these young men as they continue their journey in discernment to the priesthood, as they continue their also hiking for vocations and going to their next parish in Valley at Blessed Sacrament Parish. Asking God for their safety to arrive there safe in their destination. But all of us are, as St. Paul says, on this race. But our race is to eternal life. And the vehicle is grace. so that all of us may further the mission of Jesus. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let us also pray for an increase in vocations to the priesthood and consecrated life, especially from members of our own parish family. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Good and gracious God, we place these petitions before you. If they are in accord with your holy will, we ask you to grant them through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Pray, sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all of his holy church.
Sanctify, O Lord, we pray these offerings here made to celebrate the glorious transfiguration of your only begotten Son, and by his radiant splendor cleanse us from the stains of sin. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For he revealed his glory in the presence of chosen witnesses, and filled with his, with the greatest splendor, that bodily form which he shares with all humanity, that the scandal of the cross might be removed from the hearts of his disciples, and that he might show how in the body of the whole church is to be fulfilled what so wonderfully shone forth first in its head. And so with the powers of heaven we worship you constantly on earth, and before your majesty without end, we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest.
You are take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you. The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Nelson, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them to the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles and of all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, you said to your apostles, Peace I give you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sin, but on the faith of your church. And graciously grant peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with all of you.
And with your spirit.
Thank you.
When Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is.
Thank you.
So I just want to say my name is Andrew. I am from the Diocese of Harrisburg. I just finished my philosophical training and studies at the seminary, and will be entering into major seminary for theological studies. So as of now, hopefully, I'm 4 years away from ordination to priesthood, and just want to share with you how did I get here, and what's going on right now. So when I was 11 years old, back in the parish of Lancaster County, my pastor at the time said to me before Mass as I was getting ready, as I was serving that day, and he says, "Andrew, you're going to be a priest." I looked at him, and I said, "Father, you're a crazy old man. There's no way that's happening. I'm sorry, no way." But one thing that did change after that was my prayer life. No longer was I asking God, "Please give me a new PlayStation. Please tell my brother to stop fighting all the time." And it now was, "Well, God, what do you want for me? What is my life supposed to be? I want to live for you, but I don't know what that's going to look like." And so fast forward to high school. I went to Pikes Catholic High School, graduated in 2015. But in my junior year, as part of the requirement, I had to go on a retreat every year to go on the next grade. And so I went down to Mount St. Mary's Seminary to spend a day with the seminarians and just see what life is like. We were told that it was going to be a day of playing video games and eating pizza with seminarians. Found out quickly that we were lied to. So spent the day just sitting in our classes, being able to pray with the seminarians. And after that day, I was convinced God is definitely calling me to priesthood. This is for sure. This is it. And my heart was just on fire. So I went home that day and I told my parents, and that was received with mixed emotions. One was thrilled and excited about this, and the other being promised I would never go to seminary, I would never be a priest, I would never do this, I'm throwing my life away, don't do it. So I promised that I would never go to seminary, and I would never be a priest, and well, here I am. So after that, I decided, all right, well, to appease my parents, I will go to college and do the normal thing. And so in college, I started dating. And the idea of the priesthood was still there. Every time I went to pray, that voice in my head, there was just kept saying, "Be a priest, be a priest, be a priest." And so, I'm now having some conflicting things. I made this promise I'm never going to do this, but this voice in my head keeps telling me, "You gotta do it." But then in the pandemic hit, it got cut short. I had to leave here, I had to leave the seminary. And like most everyone in the world, was not fun, was not a good time. But it was in that time, though, that I really discovered in my heart that God is still here. I don't know what God's doing, just like I don't know what God's doing with my life, but I know it's for the benefit of myself and for others, and for His greater glory. And so it was a great invitation for me to just grow a deeper trust in Him, as well as deeper appreciation and love and Eucharist in that time. And so we continued to go back to seminary, and year two was pretty much the same exact thing. Just continue to surrender and say, God, I trust in you. I know, we're still kind of dealing with the pandemic stuff, and it's not a ton of fun. It's only making classes harder, formation harder, but I'm going to continue trusting in you. And this past summer, I was in York City, not New York City, just New York City, just on the other side of the Susquehanna River. And it was my first time being able to just live in a parish. I was living in the rectory, going to daily mass, serving daily mass, going to the nursing homes, doing home visits, marriage prep, the whole nine yards. And it was over this past summer that finally, the two kind of met. I'm 99.9% sure God is calling me to this, and now I can honestly say, I want this. I want to be a priest. I want to follow God's will, if it's indeed what it is. And so, the most important thing is two most important things. God just calls normal people. Like, just every day, you don't know who He's going to be calling to do what. And so, just be open to whatever it is that God is calling to, and also to support and encourage children and young people. If this is what God is calling you to, if God is calling you to priesthood or religious life, support them, pray for them, be there for them. But also, most importantly, willing and begin, if you're not now, just having a daily prayer life, just be willing and open to how God is calling you to be holy today, to be holy for your life. And so with that, I ask you please to continue to pray for me, my brother seminarians, and pray that more men will be willing to listen to God and to open their ears, silence themselves, and be able to surrender to the will of God.
Thank you, Andrew. Thanks again to Father Cooke and all the coordinators. Thank you to Sue and Eileen Tour and Father Fabiano, who was also with them in the car just in case if they got a flag or maybe some other kind of situation to attend to. But I thank all of them, the vocation office down under the direction of Father David. As the vocational office always tells us, there may be a vocation director assigned to that office, but all of us are vocation directors. Like Andrew said, we're all to encourage and to pray for continuation of priestly and religious life vocations among the members of the church. I do believe with you that God is still calling. We just have to make sure that we hear Him. The way that we do that is by prayer and openness. So thanks once again. Let's pray, everybody. May the heavenly nourishment we have received, O Lord, we pray, transform us into the likeness of your Son, whose radiant splendor you will to make manifest in his glorious transfiguration, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.